grace, mercy, peace be yours in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text today will be our lesson from Acts, and I read again verses 18 and 19. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that as Christ would suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out. Here ends the reading of our text. May God add his blessings to the reading of his word. Amen. Today's sermon is going to be expository in style. That means basically I'm going to be going verse by verse through our reading in Acts chapter 3, and it's going to feel more like a Bible study than a traditional sermon. This style is very popular in some denominations. You don't hear it very often in Lutheran churches. I just like to shake up my routine a little bit. And I selected verses 18 and 19 as our text because this expresses the culmination or the climax of these verses and of Peter's sermon. So this is where the whole text is actually going. If you want to follow along, the reading begins on page 945 of your Pew Bible, and I'm going to be taking the larger context into consideration, which means I'm starting at verse 1 instead of where our reading actually begins. With that little introductory bit, let's move to chapter 3, verse 1. Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. The Jews divided their day into 12 hours. Sunset was the 12th hour. Sunrise was the first hour. And they gave no consideration about how long the day was based on the season or something like that. Their hours just expanded or contracted to make the system work. They certainly did not have daylight savings time. The morning worship was for sacrifices. The late afternoon service, which we have in our reading for today, was a prayer service. So we find Peter and John going to the prayer service in the afternoon. What we learn here is that the apostles, like Jesus, believed that praying together in a worship setting with fellow believers is an important part of our spiritual life. Yes, private prayer is important, but don't neglect prayer together in your worship services. There is no indication of how long it has been since the day of Pentecost. This is just sort of a story that's here. Two, and a man came, a lame from birth, was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple. The Beautiful Gate was the main gate between the court of the Gentiles and the court of women. Only Jews were allowed to go through this gate. Gentiles had to stay out, and guys kept on going until they got into the court of men. It was just opposite Solomon's portico, which is where Peter gives his sermon and features later on in our reading. The man that they met there had been lame 40 years. There was no hope for a cure. That he begged demonstrated once again how far the Jews had fallen or drifted from the spirit of the law of Moses. According to Deuteronomy 15, there was to be no beggars in Israel. This is the type of neglect Jesus was referring to when he critiqued the scribes and Pharisees by saying, "You tithe mint and dill and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness." Verse 3. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, the beggar asked to receive alms. Verse 3 is simply the normal response of any beggar. Anybody seen a beggar before? What do? They ask for alms. They ask for a gift, right? Notice, though, that there is no indication of faith in Jesus on the part of this beggar. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. what he was expecting to receive was money. Isn't that what any beggar is expecting to receive from you? And he's at a good spot too. People are kind of religiously moved when they're going into the temple and perhaps be a little bit more likely to give them something. But he's expecting money, nothing more. But Peter said, I have no silver or gold. Depressing. But what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise and walk. This is a prime example of how Jesus gives. The gospel is always God acting first. Then we react to it. Peter is not using some magical incantation when he says in the name of Jesus. When he calls on the name of the Lord, he is referring to the revelation of Jesus, the God-man, sent from the Father, condemned for humanity's sin, raised on the third day, and ascended to his rightful position as the second person of the Trinity. This then leads directly to Peter's sermon, the name, what it stands for here. Peter explains the revelation of God's name in Jesus, or Jesus' name, when he gets to preaching. And he took him by the right hand, the beggar, and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Verse 7, in case you're following along. Still, there is no indication that this beggar had faith in Jesus. He says, rise and stand, and the guy's still sitting there. Why would he believe that he had been healed? He'd been lame 40 years. Okay? But in a moment, he's going to realize he's been healed, and then faith kicks in. You may wonder why I keep bringing this up, the faith aspect of the beggar. Well, that is because there are those who teach today, and have in the past as well, that if you have enough faith, Jesus will heal you. And if you're not healed, then you lack the faith to be healed. This is absolute truth. I once heard one of these phony baloney faith healers tell a person that he may as well hang it up, his exact words, hang it up as a Christian, because he didn't have enough faith to be healed. And sad to say, many have done so because they have been lied to by faith healers. Yes, there are times when Jesus and the apostles heal Christians, no doubt about it. But there are plenty of examples of when the person receiving Jesus' mercy was not yet a believer. And it's just plain bad theology to claim that someone has not been healed because they lack faith. It is a lie in the name of Jesus, and therefore a violation of the second commandment. And it is a lie, as I said, that has led some people to despair. Verse 8. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. Now he has faith. Yes, it's a baby faith. It's just a beginning faith. But it is a faith, and it is a response to what God has done. An empty hand which receives, and it's expressed by him praising God. 9. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened. Anybody would be filled with wonder and amazement, naturally. They were dumbfounded, and they gathered together, and they were witnessing the impossible. 40 years lame, now up and jumping and walking, as if he couldn't just stand still. He was so excited. He had to jump and walk around. And it's so impossible. It would be as if one of these so-called faith healers went to a Christiana hospital and started healing people right and left with no regard to religion or wealth or anything else that we may want to pay attention to. He just walked through the hospital and said, heal, 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 heal. And hospital was emptied out that day. Impossible? Then you would be standing around dumbfounded as well. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people gathered round, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon. They were astounded. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people. Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? Peter seizes the opportunity the Lord has provided. First thing he does is he deflects any credit that people might want to give to him or John to his own personal faith or piety. It had nothing to do with his faith or piety or the faith or piety of this person who was healed. This was an act of God, an act of Jesus, pure and simple. 13. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate, when he had decided to release him. Peter identifies exactly what God should get the credit. The very God that they come to worship and pray to. He uses the designation found in the Old Testament. This is the covenant God. The God who is the God of the living. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God of their ancestors. We, of course, call him the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He then, Peter, then moves to the law portion of his message. The Father had sent the Son, and they rejected him. Even a pagan like Pontius Pilate could see that Jesus was innocent, but it made no difference. 14. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. It has been observed that those who were murderers of Christ asked for one of their own kind, a murderer, to be released. Notice that Peter calls Jesus the Holy and Righteous One and the author of life. These are divine titles, titles that only fit the living God. Yet the living God became a man and was crucified, died, and was buried. This is possible only because of what the theologians call the communication of attributes. That means that Jesus, as fully God and fully man, was both God and man at the same time. Not one time this, one time that, half this, half that, but fully both at the same time. It is, of course, for this reason that Jesus' atoning death can be applied to all people. Of course, Peter goes on to the resurrection. The Lord of life is vindicated. Death is defeated. Life wins. The Lord of life comes out victorious. And by his name, by faith in his name, remember his name, let me finish the verse, has made this man strong whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. Now, Peter comes back to the phrase, the name of Jesus. It is used all over the place in the New Testament. Paul loves it. It is not a magic formula. Peter now speaks of faith. It means something like in connection with the revelation of God in Christ Jesus. It's all summed up shorthand in that phrase. So Peter comes to faith. That is because he is about to issue a call to faith. God's good gifts are all bundled up with Jesus, and therefore we should believe in him. Expect good through Jesus. Verse 17. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. Well, what the people did was a terrible sin, no doubt about it. Nonetheless, they acted in ignorance. Most of our sins are sins of ignorance. That doesn't excuse them. But this segue is how Peter moves to God's mercy, to the gospel. Yes, you have sinned, but God is not going to leave you there. That's what he's telling the people. That's what God tells us. He is not going to leave them in their sin. And the same is true today. 18. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer and would he thus fulfilled. I really don't need to go into this very much, do I? Because this is what our Wednesday Lent messages were all about this year. Still, it is worth pointing out in passing, the Old Testament is all about Jesus. Peter says it here. Jesus said it in our gospel lesson. If you are not finding Jesus in the Old Testament, then you are not reading it like Peter, John, the rest of the apostles, or our Lord Jesus himself. Verse 19 and 20. Repent therefore and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you. Here it is. The point of the message. The point of the miracle. The point of the reason Luke decides to record this incident. Forgiveness in the name of Jesus. Having your sins blotted out is a reference to a time before things could be erased. Today, you know, you write with your pencil, you have an eraser at the end. That's how many mistakes we make. But they didn't have erasers back in these days. So a debt would be blotted out. They'd put ink over it so that no one could read it once it was gone. For those of us old enough, you might call this the divine whiteout section. How many people remember whiteout? Yeah, you know, okay. That's what God is doing, you know, covering it. So God blots out our debt of sin because of Jesus. Those who repent, that is, turn from their sins, receive forgiveness. The time of refreshing is that joy one feels when their sins are forgiven. Sure, we have our ups and downs, but that is due to our old sinful nature, our old man. Still, we have an appointed place in the presence of God, and Jesus is appointed for you. 21. Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. Now, I'm not going to say that I'm as sharp with the Greek as the fellows who translate the Bible, because I know that I'm not. However, I have to disagree with the common English translation here. I admit that the Greek can be understood the way it's translated, but it can also be understood to say Jesus must receive heaven instead of heaven will receive him. Jesus must receive heaven. That is how Martin Luther translated it in the German Bible. Any of you have a German Bible at home and know your German well enough to check it out? You can go home and check it out. The way the English Bible translates these words can lead to the false teaching that Jesus, according to his human nature, is stuck in heaven. And many people have used it that way. The way Luther understood the Greek agrees better with the concept of the right hand of God, right hand of the Father, as we confess in the creeds and as the Bible reveals Jesus is. That Jesus is in charge, basically. It also makes it easier to understand the whole Christ is with us now, not just according to his divinity, but according to his humanity. And that Jesus comes to us with his body and blood, in with and under the bread and the wine in the Lord's Supper. Because his body is not stuck in heaven. He has received heaven, the authority, the glory. As we conclude our message today, hopefully pondering it throughout this coming week, let us remember that the Jesus who was foretold by the prophets, who was rejected for our acceptance, who strengthens us through word and sacrament, that is the Jesus we believe in. He is the author of life, who will raise us up on the last day for our own personal, eternal days of refreshment. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.